7:30 in July, 7 o'clock in August. It's a fun that would join us there. During the school year, we have concerts in four high schools in the senior high school district, and it's a great pleasure to be here too. We continue tonight, that was a Spanish march by Vida de la Cis from the south of France, where many British visitors come. And there are many different styles of Spanish marches. Marches in Spain are like snow to the Eskimos. They have 100 different kinds of marches. And this is kind of a delicate march. We continue with music from Georg Friedrich Handel, who became a British subject in 1819. And then, of course, he changed his name, became George Friedrich Handel. Either way, he's a timeless composer, if only for having written the Messiah. But this music, too, has a timeless quality about it, originally written for a keyboard instrument, and it's been played by every possible combination of instruments. And it's just so beautiful because of its simplicity and its elegance, and audiences love it wherever it's played. We'll let the music speak for itself on that one, and then we go on to a piece by a Czech composer, Vinger Felt. He lived his whole life in Prague, although his music was performed throughout Europe and in the United States. He traveled to conduct and teach in Australia and the United States, but mostly he was in Prague. His music was championed by the great flutist Jean-Pierre Rampal. He wrote a flute concerto for him and also a flute sonata he played in his recital appearances. And the form of the divertimento, which is comes to us from the early Baroque and then the classical period and now in the modern era. And so there was this category of pieces like serenades and divertimentos. They were sometimes used on concert for stage, for concert performances, but they were also used in casual performances, maybe as dinner music or background music at a party, and they were typically dance music or songs, lighthearted, and that's the character of the pieces, but in a very modern vein. I'll come back and talk about the other pieces after you do.
Thank you.
The next piece is Jericho by Morton Gould, appealing to cross him in his own right. And in fact, he was nominated for a Pulitzer for a band piece. He's about the only band piece ever nominated for a Pulitzer for the symphony band. They won the award for a string piece. This is a programmatic piece, which means it tells a story, a biblical story of Joshua and the Battle of Jericho. And he actually attached biblical scriptures to each section of the piece. So it begins with the commandment to Joshua to take, to assemble troops and mobilize to take the city of Jericho. At first, Joshua is filled with the sense of war that this great project for him, and he's commanded to assemble one soldier from each of the 12 Israelite tribes, and then he begins to appreciate the gravity of the project. They equip themselves and they have to travel through the desert. And it's a long, arduous journey through the desert. In the end, they emerge and they're so successful, they have to dance. And in fact, they dance in 7-4. There's great revelry, and then they have to settle down to the job at hand. And he's been commanded to surround the city with many shofars, or blow the shofars for 6 days before the 7th day when they actually attack the city. The actual battle itself comes pretty late in the piece, and it's introduced by the snare drum solo, and then we're led into battle by the bassoons, and there's a great deal of back and forth between the trumpets and the cornet section, and eventually, with great help from the trombone section, the walls are eventually blown down, and you hear a great noise coming out of the percussion section. Afterward, there's some regret, there's obviously losses, but eventually the piece concludes with a hallelujah and hosanna chorus with great exultation. After Jericho, we continue with the Algerian Suite by Camille Saint-Saëns. Saint-Saëns was a child prodigy. He grew up in France. He was a professional performer at the age of 10 on piano. He was a great organ soloist. He was a conductor and a wonderful composer. He wrote 4 symphonies. His 3rd symphony is one of the greatest in the all major orchestras play it as often as they can. He wrote all kinds of music. And he was a critic, he was an author. And even though he lived in music as a fish lives in water, he was very uncomfortable in public life. And so he found that he just had to get away sometimes. And he took pretty long vacations to remote places. He went to the Canary Islands, he vacationed in Egypt. But one of his favorite places to go was Algeria, just across the Mediterranean from France. And he would vacation there often. In fact, he actually died in Algiers. On one of his many vacations. So this is a sort of a fond memoir of his visits there. The first movement is a landslide. We can see it sailing in the Mediterranean, and we can see off in the distance the land. It gets closer and closer. It's more dramatic. It looks more noble. More features we can see. And then in the second movement, we have the Moorish Rhapsody, followed by a reverie, an evening reverie, which is quite beautiful. And then finally, as most colonial nations do, they have military bands that that copy the traditions of the colonial country. And so they had a French military band that would sound very much like a band you would hear in Paris. So those are the 4 movements, and then after that we'll just take a very short break to get the Horlick students on stage for our grand finale.
Thank you. Thank you.